I am Ashna Gupta from EPG Pathshala. The name of my module is Psychological Tests to Measure Criminal Behavior. The learning objectives of this paper is, after studying this module, you shall be able to learn the history of psychological profiling, know about the personality characteristics of criminals, learn about the uses of psychological tests in crime investigation. Introduction. Forensic psychology, often called the study of criminal minds, deals with the scientific study of abnormal behavior of the criminals. It studies the relationship between the victim and the criminal and the motives behind the act of crime. The behavior assessed and reported by forensic experts provides the lead in the investigation to arrest the criminal. The forensic expert endorses suggestions for further investigation, clinical treatment if required, and or any other information by court, that is, assessment for future risk of crime or evaluation of witnesses' credibility. Thus, it has become an important source of information in variety of legal context, including criminal court, correctional settings, juvenile family, and civil courts. It is used to assist the investigators to unfold the crime and thereby get justice to fight against the crime. The forensic psychological profile is based upon the study of crime scene, suspect's observation, interview, and psychological tests. The police investigators adhere to this technique, which is an important area in the discipline of forensic psychology. Evolution of psychological profiling. Various psychological theories are linked in to understand criminal and criminal act. In early 1800s, the information profiling was done by medical fraternity. Dr. George Phillips and Dr. Thomas Bond, two physicians, did the profiling of Jack, the Ripper, who had raped and murdered prostitutes near the Whitechapel. Dr. Walter Langer, a psychiatrist during World War II, did psychological study on Adolf Hitler for Office of Strategic Services. Dr. Walter's profiling was based upon the interview of close associates of Hitler who were available to United States intelligence agencies. Dr. Walter profiled Hitler as probably a neurotic psychopath bordering on schizophrenia and would commit suicide. This analysis of Hitler was published as The Mind of the Adolf Hitler in 1972 and became bestseller. The profile of President J.F. Kennedy was done by Khrushchev. Thereafter, a lot of profiling work done was which mainly relied on intuition and formal studies. In 1956, Dr. James Broussel, a psychiatrist, was asked to study the case of Mad Bomber, in which he profiled George Metesky, an unmarried foreign self-educated in mid-50s living in Connecticut, paranoid and with vendetta against COD, Edison Power Company, who was alleged to plant 30 bombs in 16 years in New York. This helped the New York police to identify George Metesky and solve the case. In 1972, FBI formed Behavioral Science Unit, BSU, to investigate the serial murderer and rape cases. From 1976 to 1979, BSU and FBI team members, along with the prominent profilers John Douglas and Robert Ressler, interviewed 36 serial murderers and rapists to develop theory and categories of different types of offenders. The FBI has given the theory of organized crime and disorganized crime. Organized crime. An organized criminal engages in a great deal of planning before executing the crime. He chooses victim who is at low risk for being apprehended. He controls crime scene and does clever manipulation before and after crime. He typically leaves behind the evidence at the crime scene. The organized criminal is usually methodological, manipulative, and cunning with an amiable facade. typical like a psychopath or sociopath or antisocial personality. Disorganized crime. The disorganized criminal is mentally unstable and suffering from personality disorder like schizoid, borderline, or sometimes major mental illness like schizophrenia. Generally, he is physically unattractive, unkempt, dishevelled, and quite putting off for a woman. He is a loner and has limited interaction with females. He has poor self-image and verbal skills. He picks up victim impulsively, because of which he is usually caught after one or two criminal attempts. The personality characteristics are broadly classified under. John Douglas developed a systematic way to detect and classify major personality and behavioral characteristics of a criminal based upon the analysis of the crime or crimes he has committed. He has given the steps to follow while developing the profile of a criminal. First, data assimilation. It involves the collection of all available information at the place of offense, victim, and witness from as many sources as possible. For example, police reports, victim profile, autopsy report, photographs of crime scene, and statements. Second, crime classification. It integrates the information into a framework which classifies offenders into organized or disorganized. Third, crime scene reconstruction. The expert reconstructs the crime scene to generate hypothesis about the behavioral sequence of the crime, that is, behavior of victim and sequence of act. Fourth, identify the offender's signature. On observing the crime scene, the expert makes an attempt to understand the behavior of the criminal at the time of the crime to satisfy his psychological needs. Next, generating a profile. It includes hypothesis about geographical location of the criminal and his reason for the selection of the victim, the criminal's physical characteristics, behavioral habits, and abnormal behavior at the time of committing crime. The profile generated gives specific information about criminals, such as a demographic information, such as age, race, occupational skills, marital status, and socioeconomic status. B. Educational level and estimates of intellectual functioning. C. Legal and arrest history. D. Military background. E. Family characteristics. F. Habits and social interest. G. Evidence in relation to the crime scene. H. Age and type of vehicle. I. Personality characteristics, including possible form of psychotherapy and suggested interview techniques. Next, apprehension. The profile developed is thereby cross-checked with the suspect or suspects to establish his or her association with the crime. The use of psychological tests in crime investigation. The objective of the psychological test is to measure the underlying psychopathology as well as personality of the suspect, who is the suspect of the crime. It gives an indication of the suspect's antisocial personality, deviant behavior, and other factors of personality which can instigate the criminal towards crime. Various types of psychological tests which are objective, valid, and reliable are developed to identify the criminal. Psychological tests like Reschler's Adult Intelligence Test, developed by Reschler in 1939, Standard Progressive Matrices, developed by Raven, Miniostar Multiphasic Personality Test, MMPI, and test for malingering, Beck Depression Inventory, Cognitive Symptom Checklist, Sentence Completion Test, Miller Forensic Assessment of System Test, Miller Forensic Structured Inventory, Rogers Criminal Responsibility Assessment Scale, Multiphasic Personality Questionnaire, Temperament Character Inventory, TCI are used in field of forensic psychology. The intelligence test is applied to measure the verbal and performance intelligence of the individual. It measures individual capacity to plan, organize, and execute the thought. It also evaluates the level of abstract thinking and logical ability. A study concluded that psychopaths have higher intelligence level compared to the normal suspects. The probability of suspects with higher IQ, particularly in verbal intelligence, was also observed to indulge in violent crime at the later stage of their life. Some of the commonly used tests are described below. MMPI-2RF, Miniosta Multiphasic Personality Inventory, 2nd edition, restructured form, is a revised 338 item version of the MMPI-2 designed to provide an exhaustive and efficient assessment of a broad range of clinically significant psychiatric symptoms, including personality characteristics, behavioral tendencies, interpersonal functioning, and interest. It is comprised of 8 validity scales and 42 substantive scales. The test is appropriate for individuals 18 years and older who have a reading level between the 4th and the 5th grade. Second, PAI, Personality Assessment Inventory. It is a 344 item personality assessment that evaluates psychopathological syndromes for the purpose of providing information relative to clinical diagnosis, treatment, planning, and screening for psychopathology. There are 4 validity scales, 11 clinical scales, 5 treatment scales, and 2 interpersonal scales. This test is appropriate for individuals 18 years and older and requires a 4th grade reading level. Next, HCR20, Historical Clinical Risk 20, is a 20-item checklist to assess the risk for future. While in behavior in criminal psychiatric populations, ages 18 to 65. The items are divided into 3 sections, historical, 10 items that assess previous violence, age at first violent offense, family and vocational background, etc. Clinical, 5 items that look at current symptoms and psychological adjustments. And risk management, 5 items regarding release and treatment plan, necessary services and support, etc. Next, VRAG, Violence Risk Appraisal Guide, is a 12-factor actuarial risk assessment instrument used to estimate the probability of violent re-offending by mentally ill offenders. It requires a PCLR score. Next, MFAST, Miller Forensic Assessment of Symptoms Testes, is a 25-item screening interview for adults that help assess the likelihood that an individual is feeling psychiatric illness. 7 scales operationalize response styles and interview strategies that have been shown to identify individuals who are faking psychopathology. Next, MCMI-3, Millen Clinical Multi-Axial Inventory, 3rd edition, is a 175-item personality assessment that evaluates clinical syndromes and personality disorders. The purpose is to assist the diagnostic screening and/or clinical assessment. There are 5 scales that assess the response style of the test taker and 24 scales that assess clinical personality patterns and clinical syndromes. The test is appropriate for individuals 18 years and older who have at least 8th grade reading skills. PCLR, Psychopathology Checklist Revised, 2nd edition, is a 20-item scale designed to assess psychopathology. It uses a semi-structured interview format file and collateral information to assess the inferred personality traits and behaviors related to the construct of psychopathology. A total score, 2-factor scores and 4-facet scores are rendered. Next, STATIC 2002 is a 14-item measure based on file information that was developed to predict sex offense and race rape risk. The items are organized into 5 subscales, and offenders can be placed into 1 to 5 risk categories based on their total score, low to high risk. Research indicates that it is more accurate than static 99 and evidences moderate ability to rank order the risk for sexual violent and general recidivism for contact offenders only. SIRS 2, Structured Interview of Reported Systems, 2nd edition, is a 172-item structured interview to assess deliberate distortion in the self-report of psychopathological systems. Each scale produces information on how a client may distort or fabricate systems. The primary focus is on the evaluation of faking and manner which is likely to occur, for example, exaggeration of symptom, severity versus fabrication of symptoms. SB5, Stanford-Binet Intelligence Scales, 5th edition, an individually administered assessment of scale and intelligence cognitive abilities appropriate for examinees ages 2 to 85 plus years. 5 factors are assessed: fluid reasoning knowledge, quantitative processing, visual spatial processing, and working memory. Scores include a full scale IQ, a non-verbal IQ, and a verbal IQ, in addition to factor and subtest scores. These scores use a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 15, making the available score range 40 to 160, 4 standard deviations below the above mean. Neuropsychological Assessment Battery, NAB, involves the comprehensive assessment of cognitive abilities, including general intelligence, academic achievement, attention concentration, memory, language, visual, spatial, and constructional skills, sensory and motor skills, and executive functioning. The assessment of personality, cognitive, emotional, and psychoneurological functioning are the integral parts of forensic neuropsychological examination. It is observed that the prefrontal brain damage and temporal lobe dysfunction plays an important role in aggression among the group of batters, juvenile delinquents, adult criminals, sexual offenders, psychopaths, and schizophrenics. The study conducted on the risk of violent criminal behavior among the 2 groups of schizophrenic patients who have neuropsychological impairment and who do not have neuropsychological impairment observed that specific neuropsychological deficits increase the likelihood of schizophrenic men to murder the family members due to impaired capacity to inhibit impulsive violent aggression. Projective techniques such as Rorschach, thematic apperception test, Bender Gestalt test, and draw a person test, an Indian adaptation, etc., are designed for suspects to respond to unstructured, semi-structured, or ambiguous stimuli, which reveals hidden emotions, desires, and internal conflicts. The experts believe that more freely the suspect responds, the better is his or her psychological interpretation. The paper-pencil tests done not give complete freedom of choice of expression, and therefore some researchers and clinicians prefer to use projective techniques. In projective tests, a person is shown ambiguous stimuli, that is unstructured shapes or pictures, and is asked to respond to it in an elaborative way. Such stimuli allow complete freedom in projecting his or her own interests, needs, and feelings on tests. Projective tests are believed to be sensitive to unconscious dimensions of personality. The use of defense mechanisms, latent impulses, fear, insecurities, and anxieties are inferred from the data gathered on test and observation made during testing situation. It also depicts early signs of psychiatric illness. In forensic field, the projective technique is not only used as personality assessment, but it is collaborated with established forensic techniques like polygraph, computerized polygraph, brain electrical oscillation signature profiling, and narcoanalysis test. The correlation between the psychological test and the other forensic tests, such as polygraph, brain electric oscillation signature profiling, and narcoanalysis text, makes the forensic psychological report a scientific and objective report. Art is a natural way of exploring creative ideas, expressing desires, needs, conflicts, and exercise control over perceived realities. The draw a person test depicts not only the intellectual capacity but also the hidden unexpressed desires and conflicts of personality through the drawing. The suspect is asked to draw a human being. In doing so, he or she expresses his or herself, which reveals deep-rooted thoughts and emotions. In a study conducted on 57 students, it was observed that there is significant difference between stressful and non-stressful conditions for the male and female drawings, respectively. It gave the analysis of individuals' present frame of mind, personality type, and other unique characteristics. The draw-a-person screening procedure for emotional disturbance is recent and psychometrically advanced test for assessment of emotional disturbance in children and adults. The drawing seems to be effective in identifying liars because they have poor knowledge in working out the details of crime incident. Someone who is telling the truth already has a visual image of where he was and what happened, but liars will have to manufacture the details regarding the crime incident. It's easier to fabricate something verbally than to visualize and then reproduce it on a paper. A free hand is given to the subject to draw male or female, which makes the test objective in nature. The projection on DAP test will give the information about the self and suspect's perception towards environment and influential person in suspect's life. A study of projective drawings by sexually abused victims of minor age reported that each child focused on the genitals and private body parts in their drawings. Drawings of children who were victims of relations tend to minimize or maximize sexual features. Researchers hypothesized that several tendencies are evident in the scribbles and drawings of liars, which are otherwise not found in non-liars. The liars and non-liars were asked to draw the details of a location where they have not gone or met anyone. It was observed that non-liars used a shoulder camera perspective to draw the situation in a direct line on sight view, which indicated factual information of truth. The liars group used the overhead camera perspective, indicating a sense of detachment from the situation. The possibility of truthful drawing is more significant than the non-truthful drawings. Case example: a psychological profile of a serial killer. The serial killer is profiled to have tendency to lie and manipulate. He takes pleasure in animal cruelty, takes the feedback about his crime through newspaper or revisit crime scene. The serial killer usually targets the lonely persons or prostitutes. His method of committing crime usually involves humiliating and degrading the victim, tying and torturing for his sexual arousal and pleasure. Victim uses ligature to tie the deceased, humiliate and degrade the victim, tortures the deceased for his sexual arousal and pleasure. He depicts his sadist behavior by showing his cruelty towards animals, remains socially withdrawn and aloof from family and friends. His method of killing the victim involves tying and prolonging the torture for his sexual excitement and sadist pleasure. The onset of his psychopathology is exhibited in early childhood by watching excessive pornography and child sexual abuse. The serial killer is meticulous in planning and execution of his act of crime. He leaves an idiosyncratic behavior, signature marks, and an outgrown of fantasies which helps in the detection. In conclusion, forensic psychology, often called the study of criminal minds, deals with the scientific study of abnormal behavior of the criminals. It studies the relationship between the victim and the criminal and the motives behind the act of the crime. The behavior assessed and reported by forensic experts provide the lead in the investigation to arrest the criminal. The forensic psychological profile is based upon the study of crime scene, suspects' observation, interview, and psychological tests. The police investigators adhere to this technique, which is an important area in the discipline of forensic psychology. There are a range of valid and reliable tools for identifying and assessing the criminal behaviors. These tools must be used to help with decision making and implication of structured actions. Furthermore, the initial step of the process is to ensure having the proper training as well as necessary experience before using a tool. Nonetheless, a better understanding is needed of all the risk and protective factors surrounding the processes of persisting in and abandoning an offending trajectory for both boys and girls for different age groups and at specific transition points in their development. More in-depth knowledge of risk and protective factors would facilitate the selection of tools in order to improve the screening of young people, more accurately assess their level of risk of offending, and implement effectively preventive programs based on research into at-risk youth. Thank you for joining in.